Hey. Thanks. It's been a little bit. It's been a minute. I want to start just by saying thank you. The last few months have been what I needed in more ways than I can possibly put into words to recharge and reconnect and refresh and get ready for the next season. Over time, ministry is an incredible joy and it's an incredible privilege. Over time, though, even the greatest privileges and joys can take a toll, right, and can kind of wear. And it's not wearing physically like some jobs. It's actually wearing on a soul level. And so that's what this was about. This was about, what does it look like to refresh and renew at a soul level? One of my prayers throughout this entire season was from Psalm 23, which if you've been in church a while, you know, right? Restore my soul. And I feel like I'm there. I feel like I'm coming back in a much healthier, much better place. But that's possible because of you. So many of you who stepped up and stepped out and served and made this season run so seamlessly and so smooth. Just this morning, I have heard so many people tell me, man, things just went off without a hitch. It was so smooth. We didn't have any glitches. There were no problems. Everything was so great. I was like, well, clearly the problem is me. it was so great. That happened because of you. So I just want to say thank you. The elders here, the staff here, the ministry leaders here stepped up in a huge way. So if you see one of them, you need to tell them thank you. Because they made this possible. I have so many things I want to share, so many things I want to tell you, and I'm not going to do it all this morning because, it would take a while. What I want to do is I want to zero in on an idea. And the idea as we start the Easter season today, the idea that I want to start with is the idea of expectations. Now, I went into this season with certain expectations, because we all do. And I'm an expectations guy. I think you have expectations. You lean into a season with expectation because of what you want to see. So often expectations come from where you are, your posture. And I want my posture always to be expectant. I want to be expecting what God is going to do. I want to be expectant for where we're going to see him move. I've always been that way. I've always leaned in toward expectations, even before I knew Jesus, but when I met Jesus when I was in college, obviously that took a whole different level. Everything changed at that point. I remember one of the first concerts I ever went to back then was a group called Petra. Any of you old enough to remember Petra? Yeah? So Petra is on their 50th anniversary tour this year. Yeah, you're welcome. Because when I read that, I was like, that can't possibly be right. How did that work? I remember getting tickets to this concert. It was general admission, so you could sit wherever you want. And I was so excited because I knew exactly where I wanted to sit. You may notice that when I come in here, I sit right over here directly in front of the subs, right? And the reason for that is I want to feel the music. Well, I'm going to the Petra concert, and where do you think I'm going to sit? I'm going to sit right in front of the subs, right? I want to feel it. I want to be right in front of the speaker array. I want to feel the music. And so that's where I sat. I went in with that expectation, and I heard this. Are you ready? I am on the rock. That's the foundation. Feel that, right? Expectant, wanting to see, wanting to experience something. Our expectations matter. But it's funny, expectations happen in all areas of our lives, and sometimes our expectations are not met, are they? Sometimes we walk in with an expectation, and all of a sudden that's not what happens. Now I walked into this relationship, and that expectation's not bad. I walked into this job or this career and I thought this and That's not exactly how that worked. I thought I was going to be on a long run here, and that ended. Now what? We had expectations, but those expectations were dashed and shattered. Now what? And we're left really with questions. Why? How? Should I have seen? Should I have noticed? Should I have changed my expectations? Expectations are funny things. Sometimes they're exactly what we want. Sometimes what we want is exactly what happens, and sometimes not at all. What I want to do today is I want to look at a passage from one of the biographies of Jesus, the one that Matthew wrote, and I want us to look at what happened on the Sunday before the crucifixion, what has been called Palm Sunday. And maybe in the church tradition you grew up in, on Palm Sunday you walked in and everybody has these palm branches, right? And the kids have the palm branches and they're waving them and it's a big deal. What I want us to do is I want to look at this from what might be a different perspective for you. And I want us to look at what that meant and why that happened and why it matters for you. I want to look at the expectations that day. So if you want to turn in your Bible, if you have a Bible with you and you want to turn to Matthew chapter 21, you can do that. We're also going to have it on the screens. Now, when they drew near to Jerusalem, that's Jesus and the disciples, they're on their way to Jerusalem. Jesus has told them, this is our last trip. We're going to Jerusalem. And they came to Bethphage, to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go into the village in front of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, the Lord needs them. And he will send them at once. So that sounds a little weird. I'm going to send two people into the city, and I want you to go find this donkey and this colt that you're going to find, and I want you to just untie them and bring them to me. You know, some might call that larceny, right? Like, we're just going to go take people's stuff and, like, walk away with it? And if somebody asks you, hey, that's my stuff, say the Lord needs. Now, clearly Jesus had arranged this previously, and this is the password, so to speak, because this is weird, like at first blush. You'd be like, what is going on? This is prearranged. This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, that is the prophet Zephaniah, or Zechariah. In Zechariah chapter 9, we read these words, say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, humble, mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden. This was a section of the prophets that was known to point forward to the Messiah, the promised one, the anointed one, the king who would come. And how's he going to come? On a war horse? No. On a colt. Foal of a beast of burden. Riding on a donkey. Not exactly the most awe-inspiring animal, a donkey. You don't look at a donkey and think, wow. And that's how Jesus is going to come into Jerusalem. That's how he's going to come into the city. So the disciples, they went and they did exactly what Jesus had told them. That's what disciples do. We do what Jesus said, even when sometimes we don't understand it. They brought the donkey and the colt, and they put on them their cloaks, and he sat on them. And most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road. And others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went before him and that followed him were shouting, Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna means save, or save now. It's an imperative. It's please, save us now. Save us now to the Son of David. Who's the Son of David? That's a title for the Messiah. That's a title for this anointed one, this king that had been promised for hundreds and hundreds of years, who would come and deliver the people. Save us now to the son of David. Jesus is coming in, and they're saying this. Who do they see Jesus as? Messiah. They see him as the one who was to come, who's now here. Save us now. Most common prayer in the whole world, then and now. Help! Help! That's what they're saying. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up, saying, who is this? Who is this? And the crowd said, this is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth, Galilee. I want to talk for just a few minutes about expectations, because as we see Jesus coming into the city, the expectations are high. This is during one of the pilgrimage festivals, one called Passover. And Passover is one of three big festivals throughout the year when the Jewish people would come together to celebrate. And they would come to Jerusalem, and the population of Jerusalem would swell to some estimates between 1 million and 2.5 million people. That's a lot of people all in one spot. A lot of these are pilgrims who are from out of town. They come, they camp out. There's certainly not enough rooms for rent. So they camp out, and the population swells all around the city. And when Jesus is coming into the city, he's coming in, and who's lining the roadways but these pilgrims? These aren't Jerusalemites. These are not the people who live there. These are the pilgrims who are coming for Passover. They're coming with this expectation of celebrating the time when God delivered his people. That's what Passover is all about. The time when God freed the people from slavery in Egypt. When God said, you are mine. I'm calling you out. I'm bringing you out. With his mighty hand, he freed them. We looked at that last year in the Exodus series. And the people saw Jesus. They were already amped up with this expectation around Passover. They were already amped up with this idea of maybe this is the year when freedom will happen, because freedom has been promised. We know Messiah will come. He will set us free. And then Jesus comes in riding on a donkey. What's the first thing they think of? Prophet Zechariah. Right? And all these pilgrims are all cheering. And they do two things. They lay down their cloaks on the road so that Jesus will pass over them. This goes back to 2 Kings. You go back to 2 Kings, you find when this king has been anointed for God's people, but he's not the currently reigning king. He's a new king. The people want to show their support, so they take off their cloaks and they lay them on the ground in front of this king who will pass over them, symbolizing their loyalty. We are yours. Here's my cloak as a symbol of me. That's the first thing. Second thing we see is these palm branches. Now, palm branches, it may not mean a whole lot to you, but for them, this was so pregnant with meaning. These palm branches go back 200 years to the time of a guy named Judas Maccabee. Judas Maccabee, whose nickname was the Hammer, which has got to be one of the greatest nicknames ever given to anybody, ever. I have no nickname, but I love the Hammer. That's just, the Hammer Maccabee. He celebrates this victory where he is freeing the people from oppression. And as he enters Jerusalem, the people, to celebrate what he has done in freeing them, cut these palm branches off the trees and begin to wave them and lay them down on the ground in front so that Judas will pass over them. And from the time of the Maccabean revolt, which is what it was called, against their oppressors, from that time to this, the palm was always seen as a symbol of Jewish nationalism. You'd see it on the coins. That symbol was used so many different places, and every time they saw it, it was to remind them, oh yeah, freedom, us, hate oppressors. And at this time, of course, they're oppressed by the Romans. And the Roman Empire has them under their thumb. Taxation, physical military oppression. And they start ripping palm branches, waving palm branches for Jesus and laying palm branches down. What are they saying? The time has come. It's time for the revolt. We're going to have another Maccabean revolt, only we're going to call it the Jesus revolt. And Jesus is going to lead us to freedom. That's what the palm branches. And they start laying these things down. And I want you to imagine, as this scene is unfolding, there are people around who are not Jewish. They are Roman. The garrisons, the soldiers, so many Roman soldiers who are around. And what is one of Rome's highest core values? Order. Order. Keep order at all costs. If you have to kill people to keep order, you do it. But we will have order. Here comes this guy who's being proclaimed Messiah in on a donkey, like one of their prophets said. And they're cutting palm branches, which everybody knew what that meant. And they're waving them and laying them down. Whose attention did Jesus just get? Rome. Pilate. And now they're all watching. Not to see if they can worship him, not to see if they can follow him. But now they have a new threat on their radar. A threat to order, a threat to the way things are, to the way things have been. His name is Jesus. And it's no surprise that it will be just a handful of days, less than a week in fact, before the Romans will remove that threat. Rome was not known for her patience, her threats. Rome was not known for her patience for would-be kings. Because to Rome, there's one king. His name is Caesar. And there's no other. Anybody else who says he wants to be a king or he's proclaimed king, he's a threat. And Rome removes threats. The people are lining the road with expectations, and they see Jesus as the fulfillment of those expectations. He's coming in on a donkey. He's going to lead the revolt. He's going to free us. We are finally going to be free, and Rome is going to be gone, and we will be allowed to live the way we're supposed to, the way we've always dreamed. This is what's going on that morning. That day. It's all about expectations. People are all about freedom. Freedom from Rome. Freedom from oppression. Freedom from persecution. Jesus is about freedom too. But Jesus is about freedom. Freedom to new life. Freedom to live in his place. Those don't match. Jesus is not going to meet the expectations of the crowd. They all expect him to, you know, lead the revolt. To begin to fight the battle. He's not going to do that. He's going to do something different. There's a question that I would love to ask the people on the road. And if we were able to do that, if we were able to ask them this question, why are you celebrating? You know what I think the answer would be? Because Rome's about to get kicked out. Because we're about to be free the way we've dreamed. Because things are finally about to happen the way we've been waiting. Now, contrast the people along the roadway who are cheering for Jesus with the people who live in the city, the people who are the Jerusalemites. Remember what their question is when they see this guy come in and all these crowds and all this noise and the palms and the cloaks? Remember what they ask? Who is this guy? Who is this guy? That's not because they didn't know who he was. Jesus has been in and out of Jerusalem for 3 years. They knew of him. But they had never seen anything like what they saw on that Palm Sunday, where the expectations had ramped up and amped up to a fever pitch. Who is this guy? And the question that they're going to be faced with in the coming days, these crowds who've been cheering Jesus on with massive expectation, the question that they're going to be faced with is this: what if Jesus is not what you expected? What if Jesus is not what you expected? What if he doesn't match your expectations? In other words, what if he doesn't do what you want him to do? Then what? You know what I find interesting about that question? It also applies to you and me. What if Jesus doesn't match your expectation? What if he doesn't do what you want him to do? What if you pray for this and he doesn't do that? What if you pray for that and he does this instead? Then what? What are you going to do? The crowds will cheer Jesus on, and they love Jesus. Everybody loves Jesus on Palm Sunday. But it's just a handful of days later, they don't love him so much. Why? Because he didn't do what they wanted. Because he didn't match their expectations. Because they wanted him to do this: revolt, lead the revolt against Rome, be the Messiah that we want, be the Messiah who does what we think Messiah should do. Jesus will answer, but he will not answer the way they want. He will bring freedom, but it will not be the freedom that they want. It will be the freedom that they need. See, Jesus doesn't give them what they want because he has something better. He has something better. And this is the thing we have to remember when we get to this question in our lives. When Jesus doesn't answer a prayer the way we want, when he doesn't do something the way we think it should happen, what if he has something better in mind? He did then. He did. You know what he freed the people from? Not temporary oppression by an empire that would go the way of the dodo in a few hundred years. I mean, really, are you oppressed by the Roman Empire today? Are they impressive to you? No. They're long gone. Instead, Jesus brought freedom that was much bigger and much greater. Freedom from sin. Freedom from death. Freedom from separation from God. Freedom to a life with God now and forever. Freedom to new life. Wow, that's better. That's better than anything temporal. That's eternal. But he doesn't do what you want. What if he has something better? You ever have a prayer that you pray that God doesn't answer? I have. You ever have a prayer that you pray that God doesn't answer the way you want it answered? You ever have a prayer that you pray that God doesn't answer the way you want answered when you want it answered? Yeah. Absolutely. We're all there. Then what? What if he's got something better? What if he's got something better in mind? We have a perspective, a limited perspective. God has an eternal perspective. He can see all of it. What if he has something better? This question that is in front of the people: who is this guy? Is the same question you and I have to answer. Who is this guy? Who is this Jesus? When Jesus was talking to one of the religious leaders, a man named Nicodemus, he told him a statement that is one of the most famous verses in all the Bible. John 3:16. God so loved the world, he sent his one and only son. You know this, right? Most people, though, don't know the next verse. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Well, that's pretty neat. What do the crowds want Jesus to do? Save us. Kill them. Save us. Destroy them. That's what they wanted, if they were honest about it. And Jesus says, I got something better. I got something so much bigger. And you know, we fight some of those same battles. Because we're tempted by that same prayer. Save us, not them. And them differs depending on who you talk to, of course. Everybody's got a different them. I read something by an associate professor of New Testament at Wheaton College, a man named Esau Macaulay, and I really like this. This is a little longer than what I would normally read to you, but I want you to hear these words. I want you to think about them in the context of what Jesus is being asked to do on Palm Sunday. Surely today Jesus wants to establish his rule through us right now. One angry tweet and fiery comment at a time. Surely. And so we pick up our palm branches and we raise our shouts in support of the Jesus we have created in our minds. Not the crucified Messiah, whose rule is rooted and grounded in love. He has become a rallying cry for our agenda. Not his. He didn't come on a war horse. What did he come in riding on? A donkey. Gentleness, humility. As a model for us. As Russell Moore writes, Jesus is right in saying this sort of hatred and violence never leads where we think it will, to a vanquishing of all our enemies and to a victory for us, whoever us is. We have forgotten that the world is both the object of God's affection and a place in rebellion against its creator. Christian faithfulness involves holding both of those things in tension. We have granted so many exceptions to the command to love one another, Jesus' command, the law of Christ, Paul said. We've granted so many exceptions to that that it's almost empty of meaning. Love this person, but not them, not them, not them, not them, not them. We've hoarded God's grace for ourselves while refusing to offer it to others. All of us are shouting about Jesus, but not paying attention to his own words and actions. And that's exactly what's going on Palm Sunday. They're shouting for Jesus. They're waving the palm branches, and they're completely missing what he's doing. He's not riding on a war horse. He's riding on a donkey. He's coming in with humility and gentleness. This is not the Messiah that they are cheering for. They want the military war. They want the one who will lead the revolt like the hammer. Instead, Jesus has something different in mind. Something better. We have to answer this question, each one of us. They had to answer it then, and you and I have to answer it now. Who is this guy? And this is one of the questions we're going to deal with in this series as we walk through the Easter season. Who is this guy? What has he said? What has he claimed? What does he teach? And what we're going to see, I'll just give you the end right now. What we're going to see is that Jesus is Messiah. He is the promised one. He is the anointed one. He fulfills all of the prophecies. Jesus is Savior. He has come to save the people, to answer the Hosanna prayer, but in a much bigger way than they thought, and in a much bigger way than we think sometimes. Jesus is Messiah. He is Savior. He is King. They declare him King, and rightly so, only they have a small king in mind. Their Jesus is too small in their minds. He's much bigger than that. He is King. But he is the King of all kings. And last, and perhaps the one that's hardest for us, Jesus is Lord. Lord comes from this word that translated in Latin, dominus, right? It means master, Lord. He is dominus. It means he calls the shots. And he has called our shot, every one of us. If you're a follower of Jesus, he has declared what his one command is, the law of Christ. You don't have the 613 commands of the law of Moses. You have one. Love one another. No exception. Not carving out anybody except for, nope, there's no exception. Even, yes. But what if that, yes. But what if they vote yes? But what if they do yes? Love one another. Because Jesus is Lord. And if we're going to say we're going to be a follower of Jesus, that means we do what he says. Because he is Lord, and that means I'm not. There is one Lord. Apostle Paul says this, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all. One Lord. Who is this guy? Who is this guy? This guy who comes in on a donkey, who comes in with humility and gentleness. Who is this guy? He is Lord. And for some of you, that may be the greatest struggle of all, giving somebody else that title in your life. To be Lord. Maybe that's why you're, because God wanted to bring you face to face with this. Because you have to choose. The people had to choose in the first century. They had to choose that week. You have to choose too. I have to choose. Decades ago, I chose to say yes to my Heavenly Father, which meant I chose to say yes to Jesus being Lord. Now, does that mean I've gotten that right every day? Yeah, I wish. I could have avoided a lot of pain and trouble if I had. That's the center of the bullseye. That's my prayer. That's my goal every day. Jesus as Lord, as my dominus. No one else. And so my challenge for you, my question for you is, who is this guy to you? Just a prophet? That's what the people say. They say, oh, he's a prophet. Prophet from Nazareth, prophet from Galilee. He just another prophet? Or is he Messiah, Savior, King, and Lord? You have to make that choice. You have to make that decision. I can tell you who he is to me. I can tell you what he's done for me, and I do, and I will, and you will hear more and more about that. My challenge to you is to seriously consider this question. Because that is the question of Easter. That is the question that will follow us through this series. Who is this guy? Who is he to me? After the service, I'm always out at the green tent, and our team is out there. The reason that we stand out there is because we want to pray with you. We want to answer questions if you have them. So often we stand up here, and one of our teachers will say something, and you're like, I don't quite understand that. I don't quite grab onto that. That's why we're there. We're also there in case you're ready to take a next step with your Heavenly Father. And for some of you, that may be for the first time saying, I want him to be my Lord, my Savior, my King, my Messiah. That's you. I'd love to pray with you about it. I'd love to help you take your steps, your first steps maybe, with your Heavenly Father. For some of you, you've made that decision, but you've kind of, you know, done this. I've done that. Kind of wavered on and off the road. Yeah, sometimes I get it right and sometimes I don't. Maybe today's the day you say, time to drop down a new marker. Jesus as my Lord. You can do that. And we would be honored to help. Next week is Easter, and next week we're going to celebrate in so many things, and you've seen these invite cards that the team put together. I think these are gorgeous. I love these. Take these and use them and invite somebody to come sit with you. And when you invite them to come sit with you and you come in here next Sunday, scoot in. Because somebody else may need the seat. We're going to need to try to pack more people in here than normal because it's Easter. So as you come in, scoot in. Think about somebody other than, well, just you. That's another way you can love one another. Make sense? Let me pray for you. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the example of Jesus who did not come in meeting the low expectations of the people along the roadway that day. They wanted temporary freedom. They wanted temporary relief. And Jesus came to bring us something so much bigger, so much greater, so much better. This week means all of those of us who've chosen to follow Jesus. The freedom that is ours now and forever. Not just freedom from something, freedom to something. May we live our lives with gratitude, reflecting our gratefulness for what you've done for us. Pray that together in the name of Jesus.